So first off, thanks for showing up. I wouldn't be here if I didn't have to be here. Do interact still. Ask a lot of questions. If you ask really good questions, we'll briefly turn on the fan that Minya brought. A really good question is worth like 2 minutes of coolness. So we were just at the stage last time of introducing prototype theory, which in many ways was a reaction against some of the problems with the classical view of concepts that we covered last time. And Eleanor Roche was definitely a woman of her time, becoming of age as an academic researcher in Berkeley, California, in near the summer of love in 69. Very much of that time, she didn't want to be ruled by rules. She was living in times that were more free, more liberated, and that was representative of her theory of concepts, where you do not have a single definition for a concept. You have a constellation of features that are cohering together. And so if you're talking about what is the representation format for prototype theory, it's somehow or other the central tendency for the category. And that can be cashed out in different ways. You can think of it, if you have continuous dimensions, you can think of the central tendency just as the mean, the average value. For things that do not have continuum, like you either fly or you don't fly. Well, I guess flying squirrels sort of just fall slowly. But for dimensions that are either there or not, then what it means to be the central tendency is just that you have the feature value, which is more common, most common, among the members of that category. So importantly, prototypes will be including the characteristic features rather than just the necessary and sufficient features that the rule-based categories discussed. And this will allow the systems to naturally handle unclear cases. Why? Because an object might be about equally close to two categories prototypes. So if you are a bat, you might be close to the bird prototype, and you might also be close to the mammal prototype. And so you will be a genuinely unclear case to people who don't know the rule. It is naturally going to handle typicality because you can have a graded measure of how many features or how close an object is to the central tendency. So the typicality of an item is going to be based upon its proximity to the prototype. And one of the first things that prototype researchers did is they measured, they're measuring the similarity between objects to the central tendency of the category. They asked people to explicitly give typicality ratings, and here are some of the typicality ratings for the categories of fruits and birds. And so, as we would guess, things like apple and peach, well understood, good, upstanding citizens of the fruit category, whereas things like olive and pumpkin are very suspicious. They are atypical members of the bird category, of the fruit category, and similar for the bird category. Robin and bluebird, great birds. Bat, a pretty poor bird. Penguin is actually a bird, but not a very good bird. So another notion that came to Eleanor Roche via Wittgenstein is this idea of organizing a category in terms of family resemblances. So the idea is that these gentlemen don't have any single feature in common. They're both white-bearded and black-bearded gentlemen. They're both men with and without glasses, but there is a certain family resemblance that permeates the entire category. And that's how we should think about categories, even philosophical categories, perhaps. So I just thought I would do a digression and talk about artist representations of a prototypical beach, which was just obtained, as you could guess, by overlapping several hundred Flickr images that were tagged beach. Prototypical mountain, pretty blurry. And here's your prototypical Eiffel Tower. I wanted to do a little bit of a digression and talk about how Eleanor Roche quantitatively measured the typicality of objects, because it uses a method that really came from anthropology for eliciting judgments. And it's kind of clever, and it's still widely used in experimental psychology. So she would consider a category like bird. And first, she asked people not about the bird category as a whole, but she had people first enumerate members of the bird category. Think of all the birds that you can, and she created a list of the most common birds that were listed across the people. For each of the birds that was listed across the people, she had them say what all of the features of that object were that they could consider. So blue jay was a common bird that people listed, and she just asked people to list all of the features associated with blue jays. And they did say things like they fly, they nest in trees, they lay egg. There will also be idiosyncratic features that are true of blue jays but no other bird, like predominantly blue. Right? So there's other features here. There's lots and lots of features, but I'm listing some of the prominent ones. Then she had them do the same thing for the most commonly listed members of the bird category. And after that, she simply quantitatively could come up with a measure of the typicality of each of the members of the bird category according to whether it shared or did not share the different features that were elicited from the subjects themselves. So just to consider, blue jay, highly typical bird, how do we actually quantify its typicality of the bird category? Well, basically we go through feature by feature and we say, okay, blue jay was yes for flying. It was listed enough times by enough subjects. And what are the other birds that were predominantly listed in the category? And did they also share that feature? And it turns out that yes, robin, people listed flies, sandpiper, eagle, all of them listed flies. So for that one dimension, we'll give blue jay a score of 3. It agreed with 3 out of the 4 possible matches in its category. And you can see I've circled all of the tally points then that blue jay gets. So blue jay on the dimension of nests and trees, it agrees with robins and eagles, so that will count as plus 2 more points for blue jay, et cetera, for the other features. And if you just add those all up, you get its typicality tally of 13. Okay? You do the exact same exercise for penguin, and you'll see that it gets a much lower score. Its particular score is it actually agreed with sandpiper in not nesting in trees. It didn't agree with any of the other birds on not flying in my limited list of 5 birds here. It did partake of the lay eggs feature, so it got 4 votes in common with other birds there. And so we go through and we get a score of 7 for it. And the question then is, okay, we have a nice quantitative measure of similarity. Quantitative, but of course inherently subjective, because it depends upon people's estimates of these features. And they're going to list some features and not list other features. But now once we have it, it's infused with subjective people's context-dependent listing of features, but now it is a quantitative number. Yeah?
Should there maybe be a way of weighting those features? Because I guess some features are way more important for the typicality of a group than others. For example, flying, I would say, is very important for being a bird, whereas this small might not be as important.
Yeah, she did not weight them. For her, it was just this pure raw count, but you could consider, even within her schema of weighting things, perhaps according to how often people list flies, and it turns out that a lot of people list flies for birds, and you could also take into account the order in which they list the different features. So a lot of people mention laying eggs and flying, but oftentimes people list flies first. So, yeah, I think that's a great idea, and there would be natural data even within her method for doing that. Yeah. Do you want to blast a fan for asking a good question? No. All right. Yeah. You mean from birds, if
yes,
right.
And it yeah. Among
yeah. So, right, I think that's right. I mean, of course, Rush is interested in these intermediate levels of inheritance. So, is flies truly writable underneath birds? Well, maybe not if we want to make penguins feel as if they still belong. But yeah, but there's definitely in logic alternate approaches of having defeasibility of its features, right? So you can have fly associated with the superordinate, and yet it's a defeasible feature so that if you have reason, so you have it as a default, and then you would override it if penguins come along and they don't fly. That would be a common... a common way of dealing with what modern-day researchers would use for probabilistic inference and having some form of probabilistic inference. So what does typicality predict? Now that we have this quantitative number, what can we do with this? The first thing that we can do with it is predict typicality ratings of the form that I showed you before. And it should not be all that surprising that there's a high correlation between these numbers, blue jay getting a 13 compared to penguin 7, and getting a higher typicality rating. So maybe that's more of a reality check. You also can predict the order of listing members in a category. So if you ask people to list all of the members of the bird category, people tend to list blue jay before emu for the bird category. It also predicts your response time to do a verification task. Is X belong to a category C? And so people will respond yes both to our eagles birds and our sparrows birds, but they're a lot faster to respond to our sparrows birds, right? And so that is also predicted correlation, certainly in excess of 0.6 for the typicality ratings that I was showing before. And there's more interesting things from a conceptual point of view that typicality predicts. It predicts generalizations from items to categories. And so the empirical result coming to us from like Lance Ripps is that you have greater confidence in conclusions when they're started with a typical member of the category rather than an atypical member when you're talking about the inference to the category as a whole. So you can give people scenarios like where you say, all of the chickens on a certain island possess a certain bacteria in their gut. How likely is it, do you think, that all birds on the island have that bacteria in their gut? And if I had replaced chicken in that sentence with sparrow, people would give a higher likelihood. So people are more likely to make from specific to general inferences for more typical items. So that is some of what typicality does, cognitively speaking. In segueing over to the next model, I wanted to talk about an experiment that was very important to a lot of cognitive psychologists' way of thinking, and it is also pretty indicative of what cognitive psychologists do. So, and it's a nice contrast to what Roche did, because Roche is in some ways interested in real natural categories and how they are structured. Things like fruits and birds. But when that comes to cognitive psychology, a lot of cognitive psychologists say, well, we want to have better control over this stimuli. So they naturally transition to artificial stimuli. And that's true for Posner and Keel. And they were interested in testing prototype models, and maybe I can just jump to what they did. So they were interested in creating new categories where they could completely control the underlying structure of the category, and they structured their representation according to a prototype. So each of the prototypes for example, these two categories is just going to be a specific pattern of seven or so dots. Right? So a particular pattern of those seven dots is category A, another pattern is category B, and importantly, these are never shown during category learning. These are the platonic essences? Not really. I was calling them the platonic because they're hidden in the same way that we'll never see a pure triangle. All we see is specific triangles. So the subjects only see specific distortions from these ideal prototypes. And here are some of the distortions. These are not distortions yet, but this shows how the distortions are created. You start with the underlying prototype, and then you just jitter each of the dots a little bit. So we'll move each of the dots, say, 10 pixels in one random direction. And that will create all of these distortions for category A. We'll do the same thing for category B. And these are the training instances for the subjects. So they'll see one of these items. They'll have to categorize it as an A or B. They'll receive feedback trial by trial on what the categorization correctly is. And then after that, they're going to be tested on different kinds of items. They'll be tested on the old distortions. What makes them old is the fact that they were previously exposed to the subject. We'll also show new distortions. These are distortions created in this exact same manner as the training items. It just they happen never to have been exposed to the subject before. You can also show new far distortions, and you can show the prototype itself that was never exposed to the subject before, and hope it doesn't blind the subjects in its brilliance. So the empirical result is that basically, I could show you the graph, but the easy, well, a easy item is maybe, it depends on the experiment, but the old distortions are well categorized, because they're old and they've already learned the correct category for them. But in a typical experiment, you'll find that the prototype is just as well categorized as the old distortions, even though it was never shown to subjects. And Posner and Keel's interpretation of this is that people are extracting out the prototype from their training. So you expose the subjects to just individual items, but what the subjects get out is the prototype. So they will extract out the prototype representation themselves, naturally, unconsciously perhaps, automatically, and they will use this prototype to do their classification, and as it turns out, the prototype is going to be very close to the prototype that people extract, and so it will be well categorized. Okay, and then we get the new distortions that are hard, less well categorized, and the hardest items of all to categorize are the further distortions, Right. And so you get this natural kind of typicality gradient coming out so that the closer you are to the prototype, the better you are categorized. Over time and forgetting, the reliable result is that the prototype becomes better categorized than the old distortions. Right. So if you ask people after 2 weeks, then the prototype will be better categorized than the old distortions, consistent with the idea that the subjects are getting the gist. They're getting the prototype, and they're forgetting the exact instances that they saw. Yeah.
Maybe I missed something. I can't really see. What is prototypical about the...
Yeah, nothing in particular. Yeah. So it's just a...
Something prototypical about...
They... Yeah.
Now choose any of these in the upper row as a prototype?
Well, no, it's only this item which generated all of the other distortions. So this item is really in the middle compared to all four of these items, going back to that jittering technique that I showed before. Now, researchers have certainly played around with creating prototypes that are naturally, intuitively structured, so like all of the dots form the outer rind of a triangle. So that is also true. Those act as even better prototypes than these random dots. But people don't like that because they don't want to privilege for some other reason what the prototype is. They say this is a fair test of a prototype extraction phenomena because exactly as you say, there's nothing special about that item compared to the other items. And so if you can categorize it well, it's not because it has some intrinsic beautiful form. So they say it's actually a stronger empirical design for that reason. What else do I want to say about prototypes? I should, for maybe this audience, just mention George Lakoff's work. He's well-known linguist / psychologist, developer of cognitive grammars. And he has an account of prototypes which basically says that for all of the concepts that we know and love, there are a number of underlying models for them. And he argues that what gives you typicality gradients for our concepts, some concept examples are better, more typical members of a concept, are the fact that these models do not always agree with each other. So just to give a simple example of this is the concept of mother has lots of different component models underlying it. A mother possible model is the female who gives birth to you. It could be the female provider of the genes that you have, which doesn't necessarily have to mean the woman who gave birth to you. It could be the female who raises you. It could be the female married to your father, etc. So in, you know, maybe back in the 1950s, all of those cohered with each other to some degree. And so that would give you the most prototypical mother. But those do not all cohere with each other in general. And one account of typicality gradients is that the less they cohere, the less typical your member of the mother category is. And you can give this kind of analysis for many, many different words. Lying could be understood as a combination of the thing that somebody said being not true, an intention to mislead the recipients, the audience, and knowledge of the true answer. And when all three of those cohere, you've got a great example of a lie. And when you have fewer than those three, then you don't have a lie. And the account is, well, you could say, well, you know, not true? Isn't that like a requirement? Isn't that like a necessary feature for a lie? And I guess the argument is no, you could imagine situations where somebody could say something which is strictly speaking true, but is still kind of like a lie. Like that old Pink Panther movie where somebody sits down on a bench next to a man and a dog and asks, does your dog bite? The guy sitting says, no, the dog bites him. The guy gets mad. He said, you told me your dog doesn't bite. And the guy sitting says, that's not my dog. Right? So that would be a potential case where you might even begin to call that a lie, even though what he said was true. And you can analyze words like climbing as having like an upward component to them, a clambering motion. And so, you know, in the best of all possible worlds, those are together. So we have no trouble talking about like a monkey climbing up a tree. You can also use the term if you have an upward component, but you don't have the clambering motion, as in when you say like a airplane climbed to 30,000 feet, right? That sounds fine in English. But if you don't have either of those components, would you say a snail climbed out horizontally on the branch? Nah, that sounds anomalous to my ears anyway, because it doesn't have either of those components. Okay, great. So, yeah?
I have a question about multiple models.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So this is from Lakoff's book, Women, Fire, and Dangerous Things. And he very much thinks of what he's doing as part of the same cloth as Rosh. So I think what you said is absolutely right. So I think he's just fleshing it out. I think in talking about models, I think what he has in mind is that these could be much more elaborated structures with complex relations among the elements rather than just simple atomic features. So that's why he uses the word model. But it's all a continuum level of structure to me. So I think what you said is absolutely right. Yeah. Okay, so what are some problems with the prototype model? One idea that I associate with Lance Ripps is that sometimes the central tendency is just an inappropriate measure at times. So what I'm trying to show here is a bimodal distribution of A's. So there's some small A's, some large A's. I guess color isn't very relevant here for a real category. Imagine people, like the ages of people going to the newest Teletubby movie. They don't use Teletubbies anymore, right? That was when I was growing up. So some children's film where you get a whole bunch of 5, 6, 7-year-olds, if you canvas people's ages, and you get a bunch of, I don't know, 40, 41, 42-year-olds, if you canvas their ages. But you would be making a huge marketing error if you marketed the movie to the central tendency here, because 21-year-olds are generally not interested in seeing the new Teletubby movies, except for in some sort of postmodern ironical sense, perhaps. So the central tendency is not capturing the distribution here very well. Another point has been made that oftentimes category variability information is very important. So in what I've tried to show is an example where Category A members have very little variability to them. Category B members have a lot more variability. And imagine asking about, I'm trying to make this question mark equally positioned between the A's and the B's. Through raise of hands, how many people will want to call that question mark item an A? How many would want to call it a B? Right. How many people want the fan? No. People kind of think that maybe it should belong in a B. That goes along with the experimental results. If you say, imagine a 3-inch circular object, is it more likely to be a US quarter or is it more likely to be a pizza? People will say it's more likely to be a pizza at the same time that they say that it's more similar in terms of its size to the quarter, right? So one out of many dissociations that RIPS gives for similarity in categorization. Situations where you have similarity pointing in one direction, but the actual categorization that people make is in another direction. This, I think one gloss on that is something like what I'm showing here. Quarters are designed to have very little variability in their radiuses. The tolerance is probably just a couple millimeters. Whereas pizzas, you may never have seen a 3-inch pizza before, but pizzas, you know, vary a lot in their sizes. So it's easier for you to imagine this pizza object, this 3-inch object being a pizza rather than this thing that has very tight size tolerances. Okay. So those are some of the early issues raised with prototypes. But maybe the bottom one here is really the inspiration for the next class of models I wanted to talk about, which is that the prototype loses an awful lot of information about specific instances. So one of the things that you noticed about this example, where the P that I wrote here is not a very good summary representation for the distribution, is you could generalize that and say, well, oftentimes, if you don't have a normally distributed population, the central tendency is not going to be a good representation. Why don't you represent the entire distribution itself? And that is the basic inspiration, justification for the exemplar model. Yeah?
One question about the prototype. Do we actually have knowledge on the basis of experiments that our prototypes form rather on the basis of averaging out features from certain exemplars, or rather is it the most typical, the mode of the features? For example,
right.
Instead of taking one example that appears most frequently, that must be some of the concrete.
Yeah. So this is what I'm imagining. So this is the mode of the distribution where this frequency on the vertical axis, where this is the central tendency or average. So you might have like a mode-based representation. It's still just as much a summary representation as the central tendency, but it might do a better job in some cases. I actually don't know of any empirical evidence on that, but that makes a lot of sense. It makes a lot of sense to me, particularly in cases where the dimensions are not truly continuous, where it's weird. For age, it's really pretty reasonable to think about averaging ages. But for a lot of dimensions, it's hard to imagine what is the in-between value. And for that case, I think the mode might actually do a much better job. You should build it. So that's a great point. So in exemplar models, it's some people just are going to immediately balk and say, wow, this doesn't sound like a model of concepts at all. It's sort of conceptual nihilism in some ways. So in an exemplar model, a concept is simply going to be represented by all of the members, exemplars that are in the concept. Interestingly, in the layout that Dr. Feldbaum talked about yesterday, this is going to be a way of basically equating the intention and the extension of the concept. The intention of the concept is nothing more than the extension, the list of all the things that are known to be in the category. So to summarize what I've talked about so far, you know, for the classical view, the bird is going to be its definition, flying animal with beak that lays eggs. The prototype representation is going to say something like a sparrow-like thing, depending on your culture and your upbringing. But in the exemplar model, the bird representation is nothing more than all of the birds that you know to be in the category. So it does not throw out instance information, as does prototype theory. In artificial intelligence, it's very related to the movement in the 90s for lazy learning, to say, hey, better not to throw away information which you might need later on. Better to keep it and then do whatever kind of abstraction you need to do only in the time of judgment, rather than doing what the prototype theory does and throw out a whole bunch of instance-related information that may have been important later on. So in the exemplar model, what you do is use the total similarity of an object that you're trying to figure out what is it to all of the previous instances of the category. And if it's sufficiently similar, you'll tend to call it a member of that category. Okay, so I don't think I need to belabor that. So one of the things that I need to show, and this is part of the reason I presented that Posner and Kiel random dot pattern experiment, is because one of the things that early exemplar model theorists did is they were interested in showing that that experiment doesn't actually provide very conclusive evidence just for a prototype theory. So going back to the prototype theory, what the prototype theory says is, yeah, I've added the P, but of course in prototype theory you're just shown the distortions of the prototype. What people do is they extract the prototype, according to the prototype theory, and then we're going to see how good your categorization is based upon how close you are to that prototype. Now, so that is now your representation. If you forget the examples, that we have the prototype, and the prototype turns out to be pretty darn close to the prototype. And so it's not going to be a surprise that it's well categorized. You get new distortions that are further away. We measure that by that yellow line. It's longer, and so it's going to be less well categorized. And then farther prototypes are going to be, or farther distortions are even less similar, so they're going to be more poorly categorized. Now, for the exemplar model, you never store the prototype itself. You just store the individual A's that you saw. But lo and behold, the prototype is going to be overall similar to those examples that you saw. And this is what happens in the model, if you sum up all of the yellow lines here, you'll see that the sum of those distances is going to be low, similarity is high, compared to something which is a new distortion, like the A over there. Those lines, if I added them all up, are going to be longer. And so the argument is, yeah, they're actually going to have an advantage for categorizing the prototype, even for the exemplar model. And maybe you could argue it's a further advantage of the exemplar model that it also handles this result that the old distortions are also well categorized, because they're going to have at least one item that they were trained on originally that's close to them. And it's a natural fallout of exemplar theory that objects way out there are going to have even longer distances, and so they will be less well categorized. As it turns out, there's a lot of evidence that people in some ways needlessly store specific information, in some cases, even when you give them a rule. So Allen and Brooks, this is a famous Canadian psychologist, Lee Brooks, and they were interested in categorization behavior. He developed a non-analytic theory of concept learning, which has a lot of similarities to exemplar models, where you don't break things down into like the context and the features of the objects themselves. He gave subjects rules of the form, if you have two out of the three features of long legs, angular body, and spots, then you belong in the category. Otherwise, you don't. Okay? And so they're trained on items. I'm only showing two of the items here, but they're trained on a number of different items that have a lot of idiosyncratic information to them. But this is the builder versus the digger categories. And this is a particular case of digger, and this is a case of builder. And we can actually see that that's a builder, right? Because it has long legs, yes. It's got spots, yeah. And it's actually got an angular body. So it's actually got all three of the necessary features. And this one only has the long legs. So, yeah, that's why it's a builder, right? During test, they gave subjects some items that would evoke an appropriate earlier member, and they'd also give subjects some items that would evoke an inappropriate earlier member. And they call them analogs. Maybe that confuses the matter. But this negative match here, for example, is kind of incongruent in some ways. So does it fit the rule? Yeah, it fits the rule because it's got long legs and it's got spots. I guess that's all it needs, right? So it's got two out of the three features. So it is, in fact, a builder. But it evokes this known digger because of the background, for example, and the specific way in which its legs are laid out, etc. And so people have a lot of trouble on items like this. And this is interesting because you could say, wow, you gave them the rule. It should be super easy just to apply the rule. And it seems like even though it's easy, even though it's not, you know, much more trouble than checking three features, people seem to have a tendency, confirmed through lots of experiments, to memorize the specific items, and they use the similarity of the items to the new item that they need to be probed to categorize for in order to make their judgment. So it's sort of a needless sense, and because you're giving people the rule, but even when you give them the rule, it seems like instance-based information oftentimes trumps that rule. Classic work by Gordon Logan, Tom Palmieri, showing very similar kinds of results. Even when you give people very, very similar rules, if you give people enough evidence from instances, people over time will increasingly rely on the instances. Okay. So in some of the remaining time, I wanted to begin to think about this a little bit formally. And I, I'm giving you this model because it's a relatively easy mathematical model that will also give you a flavor for what a lot of cognitive psychologists do when they try to think about building computational models to explain human psychological behavior. This is a model called the generalized context model from my colleague Nasovsky, built on an earlier model called the context model by Medin and Schaefer, and it since has been extended and generalized. In fact, there is a model called the extended generalized context model by Kuhn Lamberts in England somewhere. So this is what the model looks like. It's trying to predict the probability that people will give a certain category response when they're given a particular input. So the way to read this is, what is the probability that somebody will give a response J, you know, I'm pressing the category J button, say, when they're given, that's how you read this line here, that's given or conditioned upon, seeing a particular stimulus I. And then we're going to use this choice rule, which I associate with the mathematical psychologist Duncan Luce. It's oftentimes called a Luce choice rule. And what it says is you're going to look at all of the members that have been tagged as belonging to category J. So we're going to iterate over K, going through all of the elements that you've associated with. Let's say J is bird. So you're going to be iterating all of your birds. And we're going to, by iterating, I guess that's how I'm interpreting the summation. I don't know other people do it, but I imagine sort of going through each of the birds, robin, blue jay, and we're going to be adding all of their similarities of that kth bird, say, to the item that we're trying to classify here, this ith item. Right? So the more that this unidentified item I is similar to the members of category J, the more we're going to be inclined to call it a member of that category. But we also have to take into account the other categories. And so in the denominator of the Luce choice rule, we're going to be going through all of the items in people's memory. Seems like a lot. These are not only the birds, obviously, but also the reptiles and also the llamas and doors. Right? There's some others in there too. And so we're going to be looking at this, measuring the similarity of this new unknown item I to all of these items in memory. I guess when it comes to a categorization experiment, you don't have to include the llamas and the doors. You're probably just including the builders and the diggers, if that's what your categorization is on. Okay, so that's similarity, but now I'm going to work backwards. So now the question is, how do you calculate the similarity of any two items? So the exemplar model critically involves a notion of similarity between two items. And the way that it conceptualizes it is the exponential relation of negative constant times the distance in psychological space between the items I and J. Okay, so it's an exponential function. Why did Nasovsky use an exponential function? I think it was inspired by Roger Shepard's work toward a universal law of generalization, where he argued across many different stimuli sets, across many different species, including humans and pigeons and rats, there seems to be a beautifully general relation between the distance between items in a psychological space and the amount of response that will be generalized from one item to the next item. If this reminds you of Tenenbaum and Griffiths that I presented before, very good. there's a strong mathematical relationship between these. So part of what Roger Shepard did is he developed a very elegant mathematical treatment that this exponential relation would naturally fall out of this idea of consequential regions. And so the idea of a consequential region is in this hypothesis space, you're imagining, one fact about this object, and you're trying to say, what are all of the hypotheses that would cover that fact? And you're imagining all of these hypotheses at different sizes and different shapes. And if you integrate over all of those, you will end up with an exponential relation. So there is a mathematical theory which actually predicts this exponential relation, and that's why it's featured here. The negative exponent, of course, because you're converting a distance in a psychological space to a similarity, right? So you write as distance goes up, you want similarity to go down. But the one thing I haven't really talked about is, what do I mean by distance in psychological space? And that brings us to multidimensional scaling, which is a psychometric algorithm which takes as input a matrix of similarities or distances, either way, between a set of objects, and then it returns as an output a geometric representation where each object is represented by coordinates, either two-dimensional or three-dimensional. It could be any dimensional coordinates. The two most typical forms that you'll see are two- or three-dimensional solutions, because those tend to be well interpreted by people. They make nice figures in papers, too. So you can think of as a first order of approximation, if you have n objects that you're trying to create representations for, you would have an n by n matrix of all of their distances to all of their distances from every object to every other object. If you think about it, many times you make this assumption that the lower part of the triangle is just going to be a reflection of the upper part of the triangle, like the distance from Osnabrück to Bielefeld is the same as the distance from Bielefeld to Osnabrück. So multidimensional scaling oftentimes makes that assumption, even though Amos Tversky shows that it's not always true for human judgments of similarity. Nonetheless, that can make it easier and oftentimes more accurate to model the results from humans at a first order of approximation. And you start with this n by n matrix, maybe divide by two, if you will, because you're only paying attention to one of the triangles, assuming the other is symmetric. And you don't really have to pay attention to the diagonal itself, under the assumption that the distance of Osnabrück to Osnabrück is zero. Ditto for Bielefeld. So that's how you end up with what I said here of having n times n minus 1 divided by 2 different distances as your input. The output is going to be reduced dimensionality. So here you are now going to be representing each of your objects just by its coordinates, perhaps just two-dimensional coordinates. So if you have a d-dimensional space, then you'll have only n times d numbers, rather than what you started with, which was on the order of n squared numbers. Okay, so in a classic application of multidimensional scaling, then, you can actually start with all the distances of Atlanta, Chicago, Denver, Houston, to all of the other cities on the list. You've probably seen tables like this. Submit this to multidimensional scaling, and you'll end up with a reconstruction of the U.S. map, right? And now you can read off the coordinates of each of the cities. Some astute observers will notice that something's off. So I guess this is a vertically flipped version of the map, right? Multidimensional scaling is going to be rotationally invariant, translation invariant, and also invariant to reflections, right? So it's not going to get the absolute positions of the cities, right, unless you peg a corner and say, I want Seattle to be in the Northwest. But it is capturing very accurately the relative similarities between all of the cities here. Yeah?
Maybe I didn't get that. Why the dimensionality reduction?
So why is it important, or how is it achieved? So the dimensionality reduction is just useful in many contexts where you're trying to have a compressed representation of a set of objects. You can think of it as a situation where you have some algorithm that can very quickly give you distances. Like, think of it like pixel distance of images. And it's easy to have an automatic algorithm that churn out a whole bunch, like a matrix, an n-by-n matrix of distances. But you can actually conserve space if you just represent things by their similarities to other objects. So you could be just purely interested in conserving space. That's the least interesting use, because we have computers that have a lot of space nowadays. One of the other things that go along with the information compression here is that you actually end up with more robust, reliable measures than if you had used the individual distances of the objects. So if you imagine, here they're actually quite precise measures of the distance. But in many situations, for example, anything to do with humans, it's actually very noisy. And all of these distances, imagine you're asking people how similar is X to Y, all of these are going to be noisy. And by submitting them to multidimensional scaling and measuring the coordinates in the space, you actually end up with a more reliable, constrained representation of the similarity relations than if you had used the actual similarity ratings. There's going to be a lot of noise in here. Here you're going to get the noises canceling each other out. So this is another important aspect of the information compression. You're trying to create a single coherent geometric representation of the distances. And if you have a big enough matrix, you can show mathematically that you'll end up with a more robust solution because of the compression. Yeah?
I think it's not just because of reducing the number of objects, the big N, that how much the D dimension is smaller than this. But maybe the initial set of observations, they have like K dimension values, each of the observations. And then you reduce it to like 2 dimensions. This is another advantage of
so. Yeah, but my question was, why should we do that before the end of the algorithm? Usually, even in machine learning, when we have a feature vector or something like that, we do the dimensionality reduction at the end of the process.
Yeah.
Yeah. Number 2 step. I mean.
Yeah.
So it's early to have dimensionality reduction because I'm
just testing the distance. So I think it's. Yeah, I understand completely what you're saying. It's a great question. But what I think I said is right. So it depends upon how apt you think this is as a solution, as a compression for this. And psychologically speaking, if this is a pretty apt summary representation of the greater number of numbers here, then you're better off feeding this representation into your psychological model, because it's going to be less influenced by noise. So imagine there's a lot of noise in each one of those. then you can show that you, even though, so you could feed these distances in the exemplar model, but you'll actually get better behavioral results if you feed in those. And it's interesting because you would say, so you could say, hey, look, we're doing an information compression and we know that this compression is going to be lossy, right? Lossy in the computer science sense, that you're going to be losing information. You're doing violence to your data. But in this case, if you have enough noise in your data, you're actually doing a better job because you're avoiding overfitting problems. You're creating an app summary. And so that's the world that we're in here, if that makes sense. So the final thing to point out here, and I'll continue this discussion a bit tomorrow, is that this exact technique can be used to find representations for any old objects if you can just ask people or somehow look at people's behavior and extract these similarities or distances. So in classic uses of multidimensional scaling that were based upon similarity judgments, they were able to create these dimensional representations for animals and for birds. And once you have that, then you have a nice quantitative representation of bird. You have the bird's coordinates. You may also be able to, there's another version of your question, you may also be able to interpret the horizontal and vertical axes. So you can look at the solution, and people can sometimes say, oh, well, one of these dimensions seems to be related to whether it's a domestic animal or not, and another dimension seems to be related to the size of the animal. And so you don't have to ask people about size or ferocity, and it will naturally come out of the multidimensional scaling solution. Yeah. So certainly distance in this case is two-dimensional.
This is the result, yeah. But I mean, as input, you have distance as one dimension.
So, right. It is just a scalar value here. And I think you're suggesting that there's different types of distance. So that will come out tomorrow when I talk about the weighting of dimensions. So it's an important part of categorization models that they allow different dimensions to be weighted, but that's normally conceived of as these Cartesian axes. Like you can give one weight to this dimension or another weight to this dimension in the psychological space. And so they haven't thought about preserving different distances and making it a vector representation because they allow the different dimensions to be weighted here. So we'll come to this. So this is the beginning of the exemplar model. We have only one more equation to present, but I think Minya wants me to stop.
Yes.
Thank you. No, that was good. Yeah.